Hello everybody, welcome to my channel Homeopathic Super Sessions by Dr. Jowls. Today we'll be doing Richard Hughes' lecture number 8, the selection of a similar remedy, which will be continued from the previous lecture number 7. So in the previous lecture we had seen the relationship to select a similar remedy could be either on a generic method or on a specific method and on the individual method. So in the chapter 7, Richard Hughes has only described the generic method and the specific method. He hasn't said anything about the individual method. So in this chapter 8, Richard Hughes will be talking about in length about the individual method. So now let us see what this chapter has in store for us today. In the previous chapter 7, we have seen the similarity between the disease and drug action to be generic and specific type. So we have seen that the action of the drug can either be a generic type, that means it is related to the general symptoms of the drug, or it could be of a specific type, that means it is related to the characteristics of the PQRS symptoms. Now let us discuss the individual type of similarity between the disease and the drug action. So now the third point, which is said in chapter number 7, he is describing in chapter number 8, mainly the individual type. Thus, individualization is extremely important in therapeutics as well as in education. So while treating the sick individual in our homeopathic therapeutics, naturally we have to do individualization as well as in education also it is important. So let us now consider individual as a complementary to specific similarity. So Richard Hughes says that let us now consider this individual type of selecting a medicine or a remedy as a complementary to specific similarity. So specific similarity is according to the characteristic symptoms and individual method is a complement to it. Therefore, we have to take into consideration the following points in the patient. So for individual similarity, we have to take into consideration the 5 points. They are constitution and temperament, mental and emotional state, conditions of aggravation and amelioration, size of the body affected, the time of day or night at which the symptoms are most pronounced. So now let us see one by one what Richard Hughes has to say. The first one, the constitution and temperament. He says, thus every medicine in homeopathy is suited to a typical type of personality. So every medicine in homeopathy has a specific personality profile. For example, he gives an example of arsenicum is suited to worn and exhausted constitution, Lux vomica to rigorous persons of a dry habit and tense fibers, addicted to high thinking but not to plain living, Ignitia to nervous temperament, etc. So these are the examples which Richard Hughes gives us. Second point, the mental and the emotional state of the patient. Importance given to the word disposition of the patient as per Organon in episode number 210, that is under mental diseases. Disposition chiefly determines the selection of the homeopathic remedy and the totality must be considered with the disposition. So this is very important that under mental diseases from 210 to 230, special reference to episode number 210 where he gives the word disposition. So Hahnemann has also said that we have to see the state of disposition of the individual. And in the footnote, he has given a few examples saying that Nux vomica will not be given to a calm and quiet disposition. It has to be given to a nervous and irritable and angry disposition. Pulsatilla has a disposition of mild, gentle and nervous and so on and so forth. So therefore, he says that the disposition will chiefly determine the selection of the homeopathic remedy and it must be in conjunction with the totality. That is also very important. Examples, aconite, the emotional state, tension, the emotional tension with fear of death. So in aconite, you will see the disposition of the fear of death. In chamomilla, the crossness or the irritability or the ugliness of the child, which is constantly whining and waning. Aurum, the suicidal melancholia, and platina, the haughtiness. So these are the examples which Richard Hughes has given with regard to the word disposition. Third, conditions of aggravation and amelioration. It has always played an important part in homeopathic therapeutics. So in homeopathic therapeutics, we always take into consideration the aggravating factors and the ameliorating factors. This at times, or rather many a times, helps us to differentiate between two seemingly similar remedies. it helps us to differentiate between seemingly similar remedies. Example, Briana aggravated by motion and Rustox is relieved by it. Headache of Belladonna aggravated on lying down and Spigella headache aggravated by stooping. Sides of the body affected or of use when the unilateral organs are involved. Example, right supraorbital pain associated with herpetic disorders call for chelidonium, whereas left supraorbital pain with stomach disorders call for the remedy Kali Bicromica. The fifth point, the time or day or night at which the symptoms are most pronounced. So this is important to all the homeopathic practitioners because it narrows down our search of the remedy. So suppose we take only one single rubric, aggravation in the morning, you will get maybe 100 remedies and it will be very difficult to find or pinpoint the right remedy. But suppose we come to know that in a case, the aggravation time is mentioned, say 2 to 3 a.m. So we know that the exacerbation or the aggravation of nux vomica is from 2 to 3 a.m. So out of these 100 drugs, our selection narrows down to a few remedies. Exacerbation of pulsatilla in the evening, especially at 5 p.m., lycopodium at 4 p.m. or 4 to 8 p.m., which is given in most of the Mater Medica books. Thus, if we take both individual and specific similarity, the generic similarity will be taken as ideal homeopathy. So therefore, we say that if you take into consideration the individual similarity as also the specific similarity, which is a complement to it, the generic similarity will also be of importance. Dr. Dunham has illustrated the case of uterine hemorrhage in his book, Homeopathy, the Science of Therapeutics. So out here, he states an example saying that if you have got a case of uterine hemorrhage and if in our Materia Medica, there are 380 remedies, out of which 40 remedies have the uterine hemorrhage. So out of these 40 remedies, it will be a very tedious task to go into each of these 40 remedies and see which remedy will fit the patient of uterine hemorrhage. So in order to simplify it, we must then group the remedies. For example, if 10 remedies produce dark colored discharge, the next 10 may produce florid colored discharge, the next 10 may produce a lymph discharge, and the next 10 may produce a clotted discharge. So we are grouping out of these 40 drugs which cause uterine hemorrhage, we are grouping them into groups of 10, 10, 10, 10, and one producing a dark colored discharge, one producing florid discharge, lymph discharge, and clotted discharge, each in the pack of 10. So in our case, we have a clotted discharge. So therefore, we restrict ourselves only to 10 drugs, right or not? So we know that when we have grouped the drugs into the different types of discharges, there are only, out of the 40 drugs, there are only 10 drugs which will give you the clotted discharge. Furthermore, in the case, we have also congestive headache. So out of these 10 drugs, we know that only 5 drugs will produce this sort of an symptom. So now our observation still reduces to only 5 remedies. So out of these 5 remedies, we have to select the correct medicine. So in our drug, we further perceive that the patient has a very peculiar symptom as if a living body was moving in the abdomen. So out of these 5 remedies, there's only one remedy which has this symptom, that is Crocus. So Crocus is the only remedy which produces it and which is a characteristic symptom of the case. So therefore, out of the 40 remedies, see how we have come and we have selected one single remedy with ease, which is based on the characteristic symptoms. So this example, he has said in the book, Homeopathy, the Science of Therapeutics in the Case of Uterine Hemorrhage. Here he conducts his individualization by means of a singular peculiar symptom, which comes under the title characteristics. So the singular peculiar symptom is as if a living body was moving in the abdomen. So this called for the drug Crocus. Rather, Crocus is the only drug having this sort of a characteristic discharge or symptom. This is ideal homeopathy and we should always be aimed at. So Richard Hughes says that if you want to treat any case, this would be an ideal way of treating all the cases in homeopathy. However, it may not be possible to attain it in all cases. So he says that it may not be possible to have this sort of an ideal treatment for all your cases. Why? As the deficiency may be on the side of specific quality or that on the individual features or both. Because there may be some lacunae or you may not be getting a symptom of a specific quality or which is a characteristic in nature, or in other words, which will help you to individualize the patient. So thus, if you do not get such a symptom, it becomes very difficult to aim it as an ideal homeopathy, which he has given an example in uterine hemorrhage. Thus, in homeopathy, we can either do it either by individualization or generalization itself. So either we can use the process of individualization or the process of generalization. Thus, by pursuing individualization, you may strike your mark, but many a times you may miss to hit the bullseye. So he says that if you try to treat every case as ideally with homeopathy as compared as illustrated with the case of uterine hemorrhage, he says that you may strike your mark. That means you'll be very sure of the remedy, but many a times you will miss to hit the bullseye. Whereas on the other hand, if you use generalization, which covers the disease on the broader aspect, he may hardly fail to hit the mark. So therefore, if you use generalization and it covers the disease in a broader aspect, he says then it is quite possible that you may hit the bullseye as compared to the previous individualization where you are taking a characteristic symptom if only available in the case. So if your perception of the case is wrong, if you do not get the characteristic symptom, then naturally you will miss the bullseye by doing individualization. So therefore he says that generalization is a better process. It is much more broader in aspect as compared to individualization, which is much more narrow. Being broader in aspect, it will definitely hit the mark or it will definitely make the patient slightly better. So thus an imperfect similarity will be of use than no similarity at all. So therefore he says, Richard Hughes says, if you use the process of generalization, then naturally the remedy which you use or which you will get is the imperfect similarity or is the simile, that is the partially similar remedy. Why? Because you're using it only on general terms. And he says that at least this is better than using no similarity at all. So partial similarity is better than total no similarity. Richard Hughes says that he is not advocating generalization as a habitual practice, but he reminds us that he says that this should not be done every time you take a case. He says it is not the ideal mode of homeopathic practice. He also admits that definitely generalization is not the ideal mode of homeopathic practice. He again tells you that individualization is extremely valuable. You can have generalization as a complement to individualization. So in a case, suppose you do not get the similarity, then instead of giving a remedy which has no similarity, at least give a remedy which has partial similarity by using the process of generalization. Example, arsenic will often cure all intermittent fevers when other remedies selected with the greatest care has failed. So for example, in an intermittent fever, you have taken the case correctly, you have individualized the case and you have given the medicine. But in spite of giving the right medicine, the case fails to improve. So therefore, we have to go for generalization and see that arsenic will often cure all the intermittent fevers. Now, this is a very general aspect which we are seeing. So at times, this is also useful. This was reported by Wumb and Casper. Thus, by this example, generalization can be used as a complement to individualization. So when individualization fails, or when the correct seemingly similar remedy fails to get relief, then you can go in for such a generalization. Richard Hughes again reminds us that individualization is the essence of homeopathy. So he again tells you that generalization should not be done. It should be only done in cases where the specific remedy fails, and it is better to give a partial similar remedy rather to give a remedy with no similarity at all. He says that this can be done either by taking the totality into consideration or by using the characteristic symptoms. So individualization can be done by taking the totality of symptoms, or secondly, by the use of characteristic symptoms. Now let us see what he has to say regarding the totality. Hahnemann's mode of prescribing was to find out the medicine that covered the patient as a whole by the most characteristic symptoms. So that naturally, as you all know, Hahnemann's method of prescribing was to see or to identify or to perceive the characteristic symptoms which are present in the case and see the counterpart in the Materia Medica. In the preface to the second volume of Materia Medica Pura, he gives examples. So Hahnemann gives examples. In a case of gastralgia, which has 6 symptoms, bryonia was found to cover up all features of the malady than any other medicine, as it covered up the patient's disposition. So in a case of gastralgia, there were 6 symptoms and bryonia was the only remedy. Why? Because it covered up the disposition. So I told you previously that when we take the individual into consideration, you have to take the disposition along with the totality. So here the totality of 6 symptoms come under bryonia, as well as the disposition of the patient. So we're taking both the totality and the disposition. So the patient was cured with a single dose of bryonia. This is what Dr. Hahnemann has to say. As the Materia Medica went on increasing, it became difficult to remember all the symptoms of the drug. So naturally, as and when Dr. Hahnemann proved many, many drugs in his lifetime, total he had proved 99 drugs, and it became difficult to memorize all the symptoms of the Materia Medica. Hence, Dr. Hahnemann was first introduced the repertory Fragmenta Vadi Verbis Medicamentorum De Positivis in 1805. It was an immense value which helped to find the group of seemingly similar remedies. So this repertory, wherein the human mind could not master all the symptoms of the drug, Dr. Hahnemann had written down all the symptoms of the drug along with the specific symptoms. So symptoms were there, and under the symptoms, the group of remedies which cover up those symptoms were there. So it became easy for the physician to refer the repertory and find out the remedy. So the repertory will give you a group of seemingly similar remedies. However, the final decision of which remedy to choose would be in the hands of the homeopathic physician, who will be the best judge. So your goal is that to find out the correct remedy in a given case with the help of the repertory. Repertory is just an aid. It will tell you the group of seemingly similar remedies. The remedy which you have to choose will depend upon the knowledge of the homeopathic physician. So the final court of appeal is the Materia Medica. The repertory is just an aid. The second method spoken was called the characteristic. So this is the second method. So first method was on the totality, second method is on the characteristics. So here, Hahnemann and his Organon taught us that importance of taking those symptoms which are peculiar to each drug as an individual. So we have to take the symptoms which are very peculiar, which will help you to identify the drug as well as the individual. He says, in search of a specific homeopathic remedy, the more striking, singular, uncommon, and peculiar, that is characteristic signs and symptoms, have to be kept solely in view to prescribe. That is actual number 153 and 154. It is very, very important. So we have to take which symptoms? The striking, singular, uncommon, peculiar, characteristic, rare, queer, strange symptoms. These kind of symptoms, which are so precious to the therapeutist, may seem to be of little or no pathological value. In fact, they would be valueless if we would not individualize them. Dr. Dunham advocated the use of characteristic symptoms. However, Dr. Henry Guernsey of Philadelphia advocated the use of keynote system. So in the keynote symptoms, or the system which Richard Eucerise writes it as system, he says the keynote symptoms are something peculiar in the case, some prominent feature or marked symptom that directs us to a certain drug, but the totality afterwards confirms or disapproves the choice. So the keynote symptoms, they are prominent features or they are marked symptoms in a case which will help us to identify certain drugs, and the totality later on will either confirm or disapprove the choice. So by keynote symptoms, we are getting a group of remedies and we do not get one individual remedy. You get a group of remedies. So out of this group of remedies, we have to see that out of this group, which which group or in which remedy the totality will fit. So we have to either confirm or we have to disapprove the choice according to the totality of the remedy. He says that if the characteristics of a drug are present in the patient, the rest of his symptoms will all probability will be found in his pathogenesis. So therefore he says if you take the keynote symptoms are nothing but characteristic symptoms, and if you take this characteristic symptoms and you will see that the remaining part of the drug will be found in the drug pathogenesis. This will help identify the characteristics with their physical differences and can be compared with other drugs. So this will help us, the keynote symptoms will help us to identify the characteristics as well as their peculiar differences which can be compared with other drugs. Just to conclude, the characteristics should be closely scrutinized to see if they can have, if they have any pathological or clinical use. So therefore, you have to perceive if these characteristic symptoms are useful either on the clinical side or on the pathological side. However, the presence should not be allowed to outweigh another drug which corresponds to a similarity of the disease in the most minute way. However, it always should be remembered that if you have characteristic symptoms and another drug is there which covers up practically all the symptoms, which also includes the characteristic symptoms, then you must choose that other drug and not the previous drug which is based on characteristics. Richard usually reminds us that the whole spectrum of disease cannot be seen on drug proof. Thus, the similia must be sought by corresponding to the seat of the disease, the kind of action, etc. So therefore, he says that since the full spectrum of the disease cannot be seen on drug proving, the best method of finding out the similia drug must be in correspondence to the seat of disease, the kind of action, etc., which I've told you in my last lecture. A clinical experience tells us to use the specific similarity. So therefore, he says, in order to find out the similia remedy, our clinical experience tells us to use the specific similarity. Specific similarity, I once again tell you, which is based on the characteristic symptoms. Thus, many indications which are derived from constitutional temperament, mental and emotional states, condition of aggravation and amelioration, sight of the body affected, and the time of day or night and symptoms are most pronounced, form the large part of characteristics. So again, to sum it up, again summed up all these 5 points which I've told you previously, that all these 5 points will form the characteristics. Thus, we follow the rule similia similibus. So Richard again reminds us that we have to follow the rule similia similibus only. We are not leaving anything to chance or blind experience. He said that just like the old school, they leave everything to chance or to luck or to or by hearsay or on a theory or on a hypothesis. We are not leaving anything to chance or blind experience. We are not dealing with mixed methods or even by the empiricism. He said that we are not dealing with mixed methods. That means what? Polypharmacy or other methods which were prevalent during Hahnemann's time, or even by, we are not using the empirical method. That is a method which is based on a hearsay, which is based on the theory, which is based on a postulate, or which is just based without any convincing proof. So we are dealing with pure inference from the drug pathogenesis, which we can recognize them and freely employ them in treating the sick. So he said, by using the rule similima similibus, which deals with the truth, we are not leaving any chance or blind experience. We are not using the mixed method or any empirical method, but we are dealing with the pure inference from the drug pathogenesis. That means what? We are proving our drugs on the healthy human beings, and whatever symptoms are there, we are noting it down. So they are true symptoms, they are pure symptoms, they are genuine symptoms. And we can recognize them and freely employ them in treating the sick. So when a sick individual comes, we take the totality of symptoms and we see which drug will fit completely into the disease according to the rule similia similibus. So that's all in this chapter, what he wants to say. Hope you all found this easy to understand, and I think you'll be able to write the exam very well if any question comes on this. So thank you for listening. Please do subscribe, share, like, comment, and forward. Thank you very much.